Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here. And I want to thank everyone who invited me to come, and especially Alexandra Papagoglou, the National Library Association, the mayor of Peristeri, and the representative to the mayor, Mrs. Mary Tsiota. Thank you all. I've been asked to talk about the important role books played in the writing of Not Even My Name. Perhaps I should begin with the first book I read as a child. It was a school book when I was in the first grade, called Fun with Dick and Jane. It was barely a story of a little boy and girl and a dog named Spot. Run, Dick, run, see how they run. Although quite simplistic, it was also quite magical how the alphabet I had learned earlier had congealed into words and then into sentences that formed images of Dick and Jane and Spot running and playing and skipping along. Some of the books I've read over the years, even those I've read as a child, are still alive in me. Even Dick and Jane remained. Not because the story was so intriguing, but because it was the first time I became a participant in the telling. It was through my developing skill as a reader, even at that tender age, that allowed the author to bring the characters to life on the page. In a sense, reading became a symbiotic embrace of writer and reader, joined through the written word. It's no wonder that some stories have such a great impact that the embrace between author and reader never ends. The great authors of history become an intrinsic part of us, of our consciousness, and at times, even our moral compass. By the age of 14, I had skipped over the teenage romance novels girls of my age were reading and went straight to the classics. I first picked up Homer's Iliad in a small local bookstore. The Hollywood film Ulysses, starring Kirk Douglas, that I saw with my mother the year it was released, inspired my interest. I wanted to know more. At the moment I picked up the Iliad and began to read, my love of literature was born. I purchased the Iliad with the money I made from painting photographs after school. When I finished the Iliad, I went back for the Odyssey. I then bought all the books on Greek mythology I could find. Mind you, I still didn't know that I was Greek. By the time I was 16 or 17, I was reading the Russians, Tolstoy's War and Peace and Anna Karenina, Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, Kafka's The Trial, and Gogol's The Nose, The Overcoat, and Dead Souls. At age 19, I read Waltari's The Egyptian for the first time, for the second time, and some years later, I was dancing with Zorba on the island of Greece, on Crete. When I was still a child, I wanted to see the world. I had become so fascinated by the beauty of the peoples of the world and their cultures, most of whom I knew through magazines, movie newsreels, films, and books. My brother Tim and I often turned the rocking chair upside down. Each of us sat on a rung. We'd pretend to be rowing across the ocean, singing the lyrics of a favorite song of the time, faraway places with the strange sounding names. And I'd conjure images of Egypt, China, and Spain. I began traveling at the age of 15, first to visit family members who had moved away. By the age of 19, I traveled on my own to Spain. When I went to live in Spain a few years later, I brought two books with me, the complete works of Shakespeare and the Red Book of Fairy Tales. People sometimes tell me how brave I am to have traveled to so many places alone, especially to the more exotic places like Egypt and Morocco. They also tell me how brave I was to go to Turkey with my mother. But it had never occurred to me to be afraid. Perhaps my love of different cultures dispelled the anxiety that some travelers might feel. But I believe that books played a major role in the familiarity I felt with other cultures. Early on, I thought of myself as a citizen of the world. Consequently, I have always felt close to the people of other lands. I rarely felt like a stranger in a strange land. I had already walked among peoples of other cultures through literature, My travels had even extended beyond my physical reach. I not only traveled through space, I traveled through time. I walked down mist-filled cobblestone London streets in the 19th century, sat at dinner with the Queen, raised a sword to fight off invaders, and became privy to the moors and manners of country squires and the often upright but financially strapped young ladies who hoped to win their hearts. I lay on a scaffold beside Michelangelo as he painted the Sistine Chapel. I roamed through Byzantium with prophets and conquerors and dreamed the dream of an emperor who saved the empire. I fought alongside gladiators, confronted lions, danced the dance of virgins for the Minotaur, and left a trail of thread to help an Egyptian physician find his way through the maze. I've discovered Egyptian tombs long before my physical trip to Egypt. I stood beside Akhenaten as he prayed to the sun and sailed the Nile in a felucca with the wind to my back, both literally and through literature, as I watched peasants bending to their tasks of planting along its banks. I even walked among the stars and frolicked on the moon and came home safely again. Our trip to Turkey then seemed like a piece of cake. It's quite possible that without that feeling of oneness with other cultures that I had developed through literature, I may never have traveled to Turkey with my mother. Without our trip to Turkey, I would never have written not even my name. It was the inspiration for writing my mother's memoir, second only to her desire to have the story of her people told. It was almost 70 years after my mother's exile that I took her on that pilgrimage to Turkey to find her home. I did it for her, not realizing at the time that the journey was also mine. But when I stood on that land, for the first time in my life, her family became my family, her people my people, and her history my history. My mother used to say, "If I could only write, I'd tell the world what happened to us." After our return, I wanted to write my mother's story for her, but I didn't have the courage to begin. Literature had immeasurably enriched my life, but it also intimidated me. I was convinced I could never write like the greats. I didn't want to write a badly written book. That would serve no purpose. As a young reader, and even into my later years, I used to wonder what it was that made good writing. But each time I attempted to discover the key by diligently concentrating on the writing style of a book I loved, my efforts failed. Bad writing pokes you in the eye, but good writing is so seamless that it sucks you in before you realize you've been had. Then one day, as if by some grand design, I found a stack of books that were thrown away on the street where I lived. Loving books, I took them home. They were all on how to write. And in one of those books, I found the key I had been searching for. It consisted of a perfect example of very bad writing by a young student, then four simple yet profound words of admonishment by her teacher: "Just tell what happened." Followed by the student's new attempt to just tell what happened. It was brilliant. Those four little words and that example were the start of my own journey. I had lived almost my entire life as a painter, but my lifelong love of books had given me an intrinsic knowledge of what great writing sounds and feels like. That knowledge and those four little words gave me the courage to begin writing my mother's story. When people ask me how to become a great writer, I tell them to read great books as a start. Little did I know then that one day I would bring others on a journey, that I would be their guide through time and space to tell the story of the Pontian people and my mother's life, that not even my name would allow readers to run along the mountain paths of Pontos with a little calf running alongside, that through me and my mother's memories, my grandmother would teach readers how to make bread and bake it in a stone oven, how Pontians planted their gardens and worshiped by candlelight, how my grandfather and great-grandfather heated iron to forge tools and then pots and pans. And then how Turkish soldiers came to pound at the doors with the butts of their rifles to tell them their 3,000-year stay had come to an end. And little by little, and little did I know that I would one day allow so many to walk beside my mother as a child on that long death march to exile, as she watched her family and world fall to dust at her feet. Chapter 19, Babies and Buzzards, brings us on that journey. The march was a nightmare I have partially wiped from my mind so I could survive. The day-by-day events had disappeared, blended together much the way days blend together, blend one into the other in the land of the midnight sun and summer. Our night seemed no more than a cloud passing across the dazzling blue of the sky, when we could close our eyes before the sun would begin to shine again, as if time were a continuous stream not divided into zones. Each sweltering day ended not by night and calm, or an evening meal with family gathered by the fire, but with another death, another corpse, another wail of grief tearing a gaping hole in my heart. Only certain memories come back, but those memories come with a reality that's frightening. I find myself standing before the scene again with glazed eyes. The years are wiped away, and I am 10 years old again, seeing and smelling and hearing everything as if it were before me now. Even with my eyes wide open, all of my present surroundings disappear, and I am back again on that scabby road to hell. Corpses are lying on stone walls or on the roads, lined up like targets at a shooting gallery, while the buzzards that followed us wherever we go hang like grotesque prizes pinned to the sky. By the time we reached central Turkey, the weather was so hot, even moving was a chore. Water was scarce, and the sun beat down and sucked the moisture from our lips, splitting them open to bleed against our swollen tongues. Sometimes in the distance, great clear pools of water lay in our path. They would draw our shriveled bodies on, our minds filled with vision of falling headlong into a cool oasis to replenish our bodies' lost sea of sweat and tears. Those who still could quicken their steps with arms outstretched, grasping towards the moist, wavy air rising from the pool, their bodies falling forward with each step. But time and time again, as we drew near, as if by some devil's dirty deed, the pool would grow smaller and smaller, and we'd arrive in time to watch the last drops suck together and disappear, only to appear further down the road. Each day my thea was heavier on my back, and my clammy long-sleeved dress, thick with dust and perspiration, stuck to me like wet glue. With each passing day, Mother seemed more debilitated, perhaps from the extra strain of nursing the twins without proper food or water. At the edge of a small town, there was a water fountain with water flowing continuously, spilling its cool treasure into a stone bowl, then overflowing onto the ground, turning the stones around it black. I had never seen Mother so in need of anything before. She had always been the graceful, patient Jules, the Turks rightly named Gazelle. But Mother left the file to stumble to the fountain. The exile stopped and watched expectantly, ready to race to the fountain also if she succeeded in her quest. But just before she reached it, a Turkish soldier trotted up on his horse, spitting out commands. He raised his whip and gave her a lash like one would an ox or a donkey. She fell to her knees as my feet rooted to the earth and my heart split open. Father threw down his bundles and ran to her. "Water, please," Mother said to the soldier. Father tried to raise Mother to her feet. "Please." The soldier raised his whip again, spitting out more abuse. He would have hit her again, but Father threw his arms around her shoulder and pulled her away. The disappointment on the march's dirt-streaked faces were barely noticeable. It was more like numbness that showed in their eyes, the numbness that comes from deprivation and prolonged defeat. Mother stumbled back to her place as the others turned like robots to continue their march. Was it on that day that little Maria died? I don't remember. I only remember her little body tied to Crystal Dula's sack like a papoose, her little head bobbing back and forth, and the realization that something was wrong crept up my hot body with a cold, clammy panic. "Mama," I said, as calmly as I could, hoping my calmness would make everything all right. "Maria looks funny." Mother looked up and burst into tears. Maria's face had turned ashen. Her eyes stared out at nothing like little doll's eyes in the broken position. And her head rolled back and forth with each step. "What's wrong?" Krista Dula demanded in a panic. "What is it?" We stopped in the road like a pile of stones in a river. The weary exiles ruptured out around us and continued their march. Mother took Maria from Krista Dula back and cradled her in her arms as her tears washed Maria's lifeless face. "Move," a soldier shouted as he trotted up to where we stood. "My baby," Mother said. She held out Maria for the soldier to see, as if her shock and grief could also be his. "My baby." "Throw it away if it's dead," he shouted. "Move." "Let me bury her," Mother pleaded, sobbing. "Throw it away," he shouted again, raising his whip. "Throw it away." Mother clutched from Maria's body to her breast as we stood staring up at him. Her face was gripped with a torment I had never seen before. Father reached for Maria, to put her down, I suppose, but Mother clutched her even more tightly. Then she walked over to the high stone wall that separated the road from the town and lifted Maria up to lay her on the wall's top as if on an altar before the Almighty. That night, Mother cried herself to sleep. And each time I closed my own eyes, I saw her holding Maria up to the heavens like an offering. The image of her lifeless body, lying on the stone wall like some gift in a pagan ritual, followed me even into my dreams and all through the next days. Each time I thought of my little sister, left lying there alone in the burning sun, with buzzards flying about waiting for us to pass, the sobs would come without my ability to control them. In fact, in the space of some 300 pages, I could also allow others to watch my mother build a new life in America as the child bride of a stranger who was three times her age. In searching for a passage to read for this conference, I found a period of her life in America that seemed so relevant both to her desire to read and life in Greece and other parts of the world today. Is chapter 19, chapter 37, Butcher, Baker, Candlestick Maker. And I'll read not from the beginning of the chapter, but from a little bit further down. During the Great Depression, Abraham tried to work on his own as a mason, building sidewalks or whatever needed to be done. But more often than not, the people who hired him refused to pay. He took them to court, but still rarely got his money, but somehow we survived. Once after, when Abraham couldn't find work, he saw men digging a trench in the street. He asked the foreman for a job, but the foreman said there was no openings. Abraham just jumped into the trench anyway and picked up a shovel and started to dig. The foreman was so impressed he gave Abraham a job, but because of the Depression, none of these jobs lasted, and he even worked driving a trolley car for a while. But the hours were so long and the job so monotonous that he fell asleep at the wheel and almost ran someone over, so he quit. "God will send us the money," I said to him one morning when he went out to collect money that was owed to him and came home empty-handed. "There once was a man walking down the street," Abraham said, and his whole face lit up as it usually did when he told one of his old country jokes or stories. It was as if he was transported to that other land, and I was transported with him. I could feel my eyes open wide, as they once did when my grandfather told tales by the fire. And as the man walked and prayed, Abraham said, "Oh Lord, please send me $500. I won't accept a penny more, and I won't accept a penny less." He walked for many streets praying the same thing over and over. He walked past a high fence and kept on praying, "Oh Lord, Please send me $500. I won't accept a penny more, and I won't accept a penny less. A man on the other side of the fence heard him and said to himself, let's see how honest this man is when he speaks to God. He says he won't accept one penny more or one penny less than $500. So the man tied up $499.99 in a handkerchief and threw it over the fence in the path of the man praying. The man ran to it and picked it up. He opened the handkerchief and counted the money. Oh, thank you, Lord, the man shouted to the sky. And I don't even mind that you charged me one penny for the handkerchief. Money was always a problem in those depression years, but even in the worst of times, our children never went to bed hungry. We never let them do without. Abram went to a charitable organization, I never knew where, perhaps a church, and brought home a few pennies to buy food when he couldn't collect what was owed to him. They gave just enough to keep people alive, but that was all we needed. We made wonderful stews and soups, as my mother had done in the old country. Potatoes were cheap, and beans were plentiful and cheap also. A few chunks of meat when we could afford it, or even soup bones, a few tomatoes, and we ate well. I learned to bake cakes and pies, and I made bread. Apples were also in abundance. Apple bought me a sewing machine, and I taught myself to sew, again by once seeing someone sewing. I sewed badly at first. I didn't know there was such a thing as a dress pattern. So I made my own patterns. Sometimes the things I made were pretty lopsided, but with time I learned, and I became a good sewer. And I crocheted little sweaters and hats and booties for the children. Those too at first were not well made, but they kept the children dressed and warm, and soon even in that I excelled. God blessed my hands, which were never still. Do you want to go to school, Abraham said to me one day. I did want to go, but he didn't explain to me that I would go in the evening with other adults. Maybe he thought I knew, but I thought I would be put in a classroom with little children since I had never attended school in America. I would be too embarrassed to do that. No, I said. But when Farage brought books home from school, I turned the pages one after the other over and over. I couldn't read. But I loved those books so much. I loved the look of them, the smell of them, the feel of them. I made time to study, and little by little, the things Abraham tried to teach me in Lebanon came back to me. And with that as a base, I taught myself to read. Barrett showed me how to do long division. As he did one example, he told me what he was doing and why, and then I knew also. Later, as my children grew, I read to them. When they began school, I taught them tricks with long division and Farage had taught me. I helped them read, and they taught me words I didn't know. Maybe one of my greatest thrills was when I went to vote for the first time. Calvin Coolidge was president when I was in America. He did nothing to help the people. Then in 1928, Herbert Hoover was elected, and with him came the great crash. They were desperate times. One day I heard some noise outside the window. It was bitter cold out, with an icy wind that cut through to the bone. I went to the window to see about the noise and saw a woman going through the garbage cans. Farage came to look also. Oh, Farage groaned. I know that woman. Her son is in my class. That's how she gets their food. Each night, she went from garbage can to garbage can to find food for her children, Barrett said. It was not an unusual sight. Abraham read in the newspaper that a man had died from eating spoiled garbage, but still nobody reached out to help the masses of hungry people. Good people, people willing to work if there was only work to be had. Then came the great hope. In 1931, Franklin Delano Roosevelt ran for president. There was a man one could hang one's hopes on, a man who gave Americans back their dream. We'd listen to his speeches on the radio, and even I was swept away. I'm going to vote, I told Abraham. Go ahead, he said. I went to the polling place by myself and filled out the forms. Then they gave me a test. Where does utter come from? One question read. Any fool knows that, I thought. But when I saw my test score was 98, I could not have been more proud. I got 98 on the test, I shouted when I got home. Abraham laughed. Wahoo, he said, and his smile told me he was also proud. And so at the age of 21, for the first time in my life, I cast my ballot in my new land. And I have cast my ballot ever since. Newsboys shouted on every corner, extra, extra, read all about it. Franklin Delano Roosevelt elected president. Men set bonfires in the streets when FDR won. Kids cleared out basements of anything they could find that burned and set it ablaze. It was exciting. And I had helped make it happen in my tiny way. When Farage graduated from high school, he left home for a job with the Civilian Conservation Corps. There he met a girl. Dear Dad and Sano, he wrote, I met a girl from Alabama. Her name is Sula, and she's the most beautiful girl in the world. Oh, Abraham said, every man thinks that. But soon after, Farage and Sula got married. Farage worked at various jobs for a while, then enlisted in the army and made it his career. Abraham went to work for the WPA, building stone walls in Central Park and at the piers. When he proved his talents with stone archways, he was assigned to that task around the city. Both the WPA and the Civil Conservation Corps were programs started by FDR. Each worker was given just 3 days of work to allow enough work for others who might also be in need. The New Deal had begun, but life for me was still very hard. Each time in my own writing process, when I thought I had lost my way, I'd again turn to literature for help. I'd simply pick up a book that I loved by a great novelist, like The Age of Innocence by Edith Wharton, Portrait of a Lady by Henry James, or William Faulkner's The Sound and the Fury. And the rhythm of their writing would help me recapture my own. Before I close, it's worth mentioning that libraries are godsend for many around the world. But for too many, access to books is still a luxury. Even in the US, staff is being reduced in some libraries, while other libraries are closing for lack of funds. In some parts of the world, libraries and schools are so far away that the inhabitants of June to know only the world they see and hear around them, deprived of the knowledge of the vastness of the earth and universe in which they live. We might focus on what they are missing, but we should also ask, what is the rest of society missing when so many are exempted from being full participants in society? What might they have contributed? In what stage of development would the world be now without the development of much of our scientific knowledge by the ancient Greeks, or without the books that captured and preserved that knowledge? Quoting from one account, the Greeks left a legacy of science, philosophy, mathematics, and medicine that traveled across the Near East, propelled by religion, trade, and conquest. Assyrians, along with Persians and Buddhists, were among the first translators of the Greek philosophers. When found by Arab scholars, the Arabs went back to the originals. This led to the development of Arab astronomy and medicine, which flourished in the courts of the Muslim world and later passed to medieval Europe. Can we imagine the existence of the Golden Age of Islam, which came more than 1,000 years after the Golden Age of Greece, without the books Greek philosophers left behind? It would take another 800 years for the Italian Renaissance and a few more hundred years for the Enlightenment. How many more years would it have taken these enlightened periods to reach Europe or the East without the Greeks and their books? And where would my love of literature be without Homer? Is it naive to believe in a world with a motto of all for one and one for all? It's through books and the arts and sciences that we come closest to that ideal. Thank you.